Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. In today's video, I was able to procure a very special guest, someone who has been working on the front lines, treating COVID patients, doing a fantastic job, and he has taken time out to do this interview to answer all of our questions about the COVID vaccine. So thank you for joining us, doctor.
Of course, my name is Dr. Harmon. At first I was debating whether to come out on this measly YouTube channel here, but it's for a good cause. We want to answer some questions about the COVID vaccine, and I'm always willing to come out here and help the folks out.
All right, thank you, doctor. Are you ready to get started?
Oh, of course.
So as of the time of this recording, the Pfizer vaccine is now being distributed in the United States. And a lot of people are wondering, what evidence is there to support that this vaccine actually works? Is there any evidence?
Right. So when we're looking at the Pfizer vaccine, there was actually a trial over the span of 2 months that enlisted over 40,000 individuals, and they observed them after they had taken this Pfizer vaccine. And what they found was that over 95% of individuals did not show symptomatic or lab positive COVID testing after getting this vaccine. And this was actually a clinical trial that was carried out as double blinded, which means nobody knew who got the real vaccine or who got a placebo.
All right, so 40,000 is actually a large number of participants. So there is evidence that this vaccine works. Now, the next question that a lot of people will have is this vaccine safe? Are there any adverse effects? Are there any, no matter how small, like life-threatening adverse effects? What is the truth of the evidence that we have regarding the safety of this vaccine?
So anytime a novel treatment comes out, there's always gonna be concerns about the side effects, especially in this case where many jobs, airlines even, might mandate you to actually get the vaccine. So one of the main things we want to keep in mind is, what are the side effects? Side effects to vaccines are graded. You can have grade 1, 2, or 3. Grade 3 or higher is really what most of us are concerned about when we're thinking about getting a vaccine. So what are these grade 3 side effects that we're concerned about in this case? Well, they're gonna be things like fever, chills, pain at the injection site, things along these lines that are similar to what you would experience with the flu vaccine, for example. In the same study that I mentioned earlier, it was found that these were side effects that were statistically significantly associated with receiving the vaccine versus the placebo. They also, interestingly, found that older individuals get side effects a little less than the younger individuals, who are more prone to experience these side effects with the vaccine. And of course, with any medical treatment, you cannot 100% rule out even dangerous side effects. There has been a couple of reported cases, one recent one, of an anaphylactic reaction to the vaccine. An anaphylactic reaction is a severe allergic reaction where your blood vessels will dilate, you can get closing off of the airways, it can be life-threatening. And these individuals needed an epinephrine drip, which at times can be ICU level of care. These individuals did recover in these cases, but just be aware that that is a possibility with any medical treatment, as your body can have a randomized allergic reaction to anything we inject into you. Also, another point that has been brought around is Bell's palsy, a paralysis of one side of your face. And that has been noticed in a handful of individuals that got the Pfizer and Moderna vaccine. But what's interesting to note is, if we look at the rates of those individuals that got it after getting the vaccine versus the natural rate, or the rate that people get it regardless of vaccine or not, they're equivocal. What that means is the Bell's palsy we're seeing in this case might just be these individuals that would have gotten Bell's palsy anyway. At this point in time, there's insufficient data to link Bell's palsy to the vaccine.
As a general rule, with any treatment put into the general public, we will have a better understanding over time as more people get the vaccine, as there's a larger pool of data available. We'll know better the rates and the likelihood of getting any of these things. These could just be one-offs that rarely, if ever, happen again, or they can be adverse events that are linked to the vaccine but happen at very, very low percentages. So this is a question that I can answer, so we'll give the doctor a break for a second.
Thank you.
So there are two main categories of vaccines. There's the live or attenuated vaccines, and then there are the inactivated or killed vaccines. So in the live or attenuated vaccine, imagine we get a virus, we modify it a little bit so it's less dangerous, and we stick it in you, and your body develops an immune response to that virus just like it would to a real virus. So by having those antibodies developed, if you actually do get the virus later on, you'll have that immune response ready to go, those antibodies ready to start fighting. With the inactivated vaccine, it's like we're taking a little part of the virus. Like imagine chopping off an arm or chopping off a leg and we stick it in you. So it's not really the virus, it's just a small component of it. And that also develops an immune response, although it's not as strong an immune response as the live form.
So this being an mRNA virus, we are actually going to inject viral mRNA into your body, and that's going to create the immune response. But once we inject the viral mRNA into your body, it will use your host cell's machinery to code for viral proteins. These viral proteins will be recognized by your immune system, which will mount an immune response. So next time you are faced with the real coronavirus, your antibodies will be ready to go to fight.
So does this mean that our DNA is being modified by this mRNA we're injecting ourselves with?
Right, and in that case, there is no way your actual DNA can be modified by really any technique aside from CRISPR or Cas9 or all sorts of weird stuff we're doing in the future. This stuff is more using your cell's machinery to code for proteins. It is not in any way going to integrate into your genetic code and permanently reside in you forever. It's just not possible.
With videos of people getting the vaccine in the United States already circulating online, people in the audience may be wondering, when is it their turn? In what order is this vaccine going to be distributed?
So as of shooting this video, many of us healthcare workers have already started getting our COVID vaccines. I know my program has sent out emails that it is coming up, and I know Benit's program,
she's getting hers in
very soon, and she will be vlogging it, so go ahead and check out her channel for that whole experience. Along with that, they're going to be giving it to individuals that are prone to developing serious disease if they should contract COVID-19, critical workers aside from healthcare workers as well, individuals aged 65 or older. And what is similar among all of these categories, the overarching premise is to reduce the overall amount of death. And by doing that, you're protecting our individuals that are at the front lines who are most exposed to COVID, healthcare workers, individuals who are at most risk, age 65 and older, people that have underlying disease like COPD, asthma, congestive heart failure. These individuals have a much lower reserve, which means if they're hit with the COVID-19 infection, it's gonna shut down their system way harder than other individuals. So by getting the vaccine to our healthcare workers as soon as possible, they can remain at the front lines, they can treat COVID, and they themselves won't go down treating this disease, keeping many more individuals alive. And the overall goal, which the CDC has put out, is to get everyone vaccinated by the end of 2021. I wouldn't be surprised if there are things like vaccination cards that you have to carry around indicating you got vaccinated to get access to public areas as everything starts opening up. And just saying that sounds so amazing if we were able to go to football stadiums and other kind of places again. So that might be on the horizon, but there are some other things that we can get into why that might not be anytime soon still.
Let's say somebody gets their second dose of COVID. Are they free to throw away their mask, run outside, do whatever they want?
Right, and this is a question that is pretty prevalent right now. Along with that question would go, do I need to get the vaccine if I've already had COVID? Well, let me go ahead and explain this. If you have had the COVID vaccine, the immunity right now seems to, by our studies, last about 90 days. That's the time where you get the most concentration of antibodies to COVID-19. It will eventually, just like any vaccine, start to diminish over time. So it is possible for you to get the vaccine and down the road, half a year down the road maybe, start being susceptible to COVID-19 once again. And just like anything, just like we see with the flu every single year, just because you get the vaccine does not mean you are completely immune to COVID. Viruses evolve, viruses develop, and you could be prone to still getting COVID despite getting the vaccine. Why get the vaccine then, do you ask? Because every year, by getting the flu vaccine, for example, we reduce the rate of flu, studies have shown, by a significant portion. And even if you do get the flu, it has shown to be less severe. So there are still benefits to getting the COVID-19 vaccine. For those individuals that are saying that they've already had COVID, so I don't have a reason to get COVID-19 vaccine, that same logic applies to you. You can still be prone to getting COVID-19 because the virus evolves, it can be different. This is something we still don't know anything about. Anybody claiming still to know anything about the COVID-19 is a bit of a
like possible genetic drift or genetic shift is is possible.
Exactly.
Just like the flu.
Exactly.
So essentially you're saying that even when vaccinated, we still have to wear our masks and we still have to practice social distancing and all these guidelines.
Yeah, unfortunately, and that's why I was a little hesitant to say we'll be returning to our football fields anytime soon. Unfortunately, masks, social distancing, this might be here to stay for a little bit. As long as we don't get a complete understanding of this virus, how it responds to vaccines, and how this next year, 2021, will look, will be quite indicative of where we're going to go in the future.
But hopefully the mortality rate will take a sharp dip. So some people might be saying, so it's useless then. And no, we are saving so many lives if we vaccinate everyone. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us about the most common questions regarding this vaccine. So do you have any last message to all of those out there who are anti-vax or who are concerned about the vaccine or who are going to wait a couple months to get the vaccine?
Right. It is very understandable to be hesitant about a brand new novel treatment, about a brand new pandemic that has hit our world. But the key is that we do need everyone to get on board, get vaccinated, create herd immunity, because that's the only way that this vaccine is going to work. So get out there, do your research, get vaccinated, and we'll see you guys out there hopefully sometime in the near future.
All right, well, thank you for watching. Stay tuned by subscribing and hitting that notification bell for more updates. But for now, we will see you next time.
Goodbye.